often talk about retirement, and he doesn't want to hear about it.
What would I do when I get up in the morning if I can't go to work? I wouldn't be able to live.
Hello, I'm Jez D'Souza, one of the backroom team working on the 7:30 report here at the ABC. Tonight's Australian story is about a so-called ordinary man, who's one of the most extraordinary people I think I've ever met. His life has taken him through some of the great turning points of the last century, and even now, he could still be said to be walking with history and with the history makers. This is his story.
I've always been extremely proud of my father. I'm proud that he's a survivor. I'm proud that he survives well.
The will to live in my father is extremely strong, and I think he would have done anything to survive. His drive to live is his whole life story. And I've always nicknamed him the cat because he's got 9 lives.
For a person who's seen so much suffering, suffering that many of us just couldn't believe or accept, he seems to hold no ill will towards anyone. I think in that respect, he's a truly remarkable person.
He's very proud what he achieved, and we're very proud what he achieved, but he's too shy to tell everybody. He just told us everything, and we are telling everybody about it.
What's down on the street doesn't look too imposing, and when you get upstairs, it's even less imposing.
Good morning, Mr. Douglas. How are you?
Very well.
I think some tailors probably like to surround themselves with pomp and ceremony. He has none of that.
This is the first suit of this type that I ever made in my life.
He's a very simple and humble man, and that's, I think, evidenced by the nature of the premises he carries on his business from.
You go up the stairs and you wonder what you're coming to, and you come to this very, very nondescript couple of rooms packed out with swathes of cloth, and this very, very small man, glasses and the quizzical eyes. You always sort of got these screwed up eyes full of interest.
Dad doesn't like to upgrade things or spend money on things, so his workshop was built 45 years ago and nothing's changed in there ever since.
Why should I modernize it? They are all good. Everything, the machine is working like it worked 50 years ago. Why should I change it? Like my wife, I didn't change her. For the last 55 years. When I was a young boy, I wanted to be what my father was, industrial engineering. When I was a bit older, my father said, "You are going to be a tailor because a war is coming. And you see my friend here, the tailor. He used to sit in a warm room and make for the officers uniforms, and I was catching the bullets. You're not going to catch the bullets. You're going to be a tailor." And I was crying for months. I became a tailor when I was 17. I learned very fast. I was a fast learner.
Whenever I'm wearing one of Kirschenbaum's suits, my wife says to me, "You look so good in that suit." If my wife thinks I look good in it, there's an implicit assumption that without it, I don't. I think that's what makes a good suit.
He is the tailor par excellence, and also a charming, unique human being.
And if you come for a fitting, if you can come, I mean, if you have the time, Then the week after it will be ready.
Okay, I'll see if okay? I can manage that.
I'm a good tailor because yeah. I like good suits. I like them to be good. And I try to do them the best I can. I love to see something that somebody is very, very satisfied with my work. And that gives me the pleasure of being a tailor.
Well, my first impression of him was that he was about half my size. I liked him very much. I can't recall whether it was early or not. But he looked me up and down and said, Mr. Douglas, men of your size didn't survive in the concentration camps. You had to be small like me.
In 1939, I went to Budapest, and I was first working for a tailor there. Then, in 1942, they took me away to a forced labor camp.
My father was taken away from the house by the Hungarian Nazis, and he never came back. My mother had two sisters, my father had eight brothers and sisters, and their children and wives, nobody came back. So I had my brother and my mother alone. Close to 100, close family, only the three of us left.
My father's wartime experiences are something that he's recounted bits and pieces of for as long as I can remember. I mean, every now and again something will come up that I was not aware of before. And I guess when you put it all together, it must have been a horrific experience.
And he'd tell us the stories of him in the concentration camps and on the trains going from camp to camp and how they treated him, and he'd show us the holes in the back of his head where they hit him with the back of the rifle.
In those days, you become an animal. You're like an animal, and you're just trying to live. You're just trying to be. You know, and try, when we were going down from Buchenwald, down the mountain, you know, eight in a row. And then the SS were going on the side, and whoever fall out for half a meter from the row, you know, they got the machine gun, finished. And the whole road down from the mountain was full of bodies on the side of the mountain.
There are two things that he said helped him survive. One was that he was able to make and repair uniforms for the Germans. That gave him a certain amount of favours that I suppose allowed him to stay in better condition maybe than his fellow prisoners. And also the fact, he said, that he was willing to eat anything, even grass roots, and he would dig up the grass roots and eat those, whereas other people would stop at the grass and not eat the roots.
They said, if a cow can live on it, so can I. And I used to eat, and I think that kept me alive.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lehem min haaretz.
Amen.
The Friday night dinner is something that I didn't really experience when I was small, because my parents lost a lot of their Jewishness after the war, because I think they felt it got them into so much trouble.
Can you put some sun-dried tomatoes on there for lunch?
When my parents first came to Australia, there was three of us. There wasn't much to hold together. Whereas now, it's being used as a method of bringing an extended family together on a regular basis.
You still haven't seen the deck at Tom's place, where you go over the dam?
In the middle of the water. Friday nights are important to me because you have to take your religion to your children, to know that they are Jewish and they have something to live for. To me it is important because I was born a Jew and I will die a Jew.
To me, everybody is a human being, and everybody is a man, if he is Jewish or Christian or Muslim or anything. If he is a man, if he is a good man, he is a good man.
He has many stories of Germany, and one of them where he was working and two trains collided and broke his arm.
I was screaming, it was very, very painful.
Everybody said that if they find out you've got a broken arm, you're dead, they'll just throw you into the incinerators like that, you can't work. And he got his underwear and whatever he could, and he wrapped up that arm and hid it from them, and he kept working and kept going with a broken arm.
I was healing very fast. I healed somehow, I don't know how it happened, but I healed in a few weeks' time. And then, when I went in back to that hospital, they started to empty the camp because the English were coming. They were so close to Buchenwald already, you could hear the machine gun fire. We were put in coal wagons. They put in 10,000 people into IT3 wagons, standing like timber. No food, no water, no nothing. The people were dying like flies.
You couldn't understand what it was like when people died. Some people were happy because they could lay the bodies down and there'd be more room for them because they were packed into these wagons like sardines. And he said, you know, when people died, they laid them down and they used them as seats to sit on.
Every day we had to take out the bodies and make a pyramid, one on top of the other, and we made a high pyramid. And from the 10,000 in 8 days, we stayed 60 alive. The 10,000 were dead.
He talks about it during the night, and I can hear him. At night, he's dreaming about it and he's screaming or talking or crying, or it will never leave him. It will be with him as long as he is alive.
I lost consciousness and I don't remember a thing. They told me only later that I was 16 days out, completely out. And when I woke up, I was in a hospital and there was a nurse, and she said to me, "It's all right, it's all right, we are free, we are free." You know, I looked at her and I thought, am I crazy? Or is she crazy, or what happened here? I went back to Budapest and I got a place and I worked there.
My first impression was that he was lonely. He has friends in Budapest, but he was lonely for his own family who he lost during the Holocaust. He was a very nice-looking man, with a lot of hair and very elegant, always dressed spotless. Very fast courtship. I was very young. He was 8 years. He's 8 years older than me. He didn't wait that long to ask to marry him. It was fast.
It was just a small wedding, and I had very high-ranking customers in Budapest, and they were all invited. They all come to my wedding.
My parents have been married for over 50 years now, and I think they've got a good relationship. They're loving each other, and most importantly, the number one thing in both their lives was their four children. And they worked very hard and made sure that their four children got whatever was needed.
Oh, they're scared of you, Benny.
First and the best is the family. To him, work was very important, but the family always came first. Children was everything, always.
The thing which fired him up most was not talking about suits or jackets or anything other than his family. His family was absolutely number one with him. He lives for his family and his children he loves, and anything more, loves his grandchildren.
When my grandchildren and my children are here around me, I smile. I'm happy. I love my whole family, and they love me too.
My father's most important thing was to have an education. He always, I never forget the words, you know, study, study, study. He even bought me a little plaque that said, don't do as I do as I say, study every day.
I never wanted to be a tailor. I became a tailor, so I wanted my children to go a little bit up higher than what I am. I think every father would do that.
My experience of growing up was that my parents felt it was important to be a lawyer, a doctor, or an engineer. And because you needed that to be successful, or to be happy, or to be safe.
We came to Australia to find freedom for our children, because we were not free. Either we had the Nazis or had the communism, so we had enough of all this. We wanted to have peace and freedom.
Life was beautiful, perfect in Budapest. It was, you know, I had everything. I had a good business. I was making very, very good money. I had everything, whatever I wanted, I had. Then communism started, I had to run away.
We left Hungary illegally, and so we couldn't carry much. We had a beach bag, and we put in two shirts and his big scissors and his thimble, which was always in his pocket, and underwear, one of each. That's all what we took.
He had to pay a lot of money to get through the border at night time. And we went across the border first to Czechoslovakia.
If they catch you, they put you in jail. A lot of people, it happened with a lot of people. But we had no children, so we were not afraid. Whatever will happen, will happen.
I started very quickly, and I became well known in Vienna. I had customers, that I had two workers, and I was working day and night because I lost everything.
And when the Korean War came out, he said, we're going.
And I thought, here we are, there is a world war already coming. I have to go away from Europe because I can't do it again.
He came from Europe to Australia to make sure that that didn't happen again. He told us that, you know, he witnessed them throwing babies straight into the fire alive. And he said they weren't going to do that to his family.
He said the end of the world is better than close. That was the reason to picking Australia, and everybody said it's a good country, it's a new country, and you can develop with the country. I worried about the future, of course, but he said, don't worry, I have two hands and we will be all right, and that's what happened.
When we first came to Australia, he had a full-time day job. He had a full-time afternoon job, and then he had work that he brought home to do at home in his spare time.
It was very hard. I was working, I'm telling you, 16 hours a day.
Never went to bed before 12 o'clock at night and early morning rise and back to work.
He's a typical example of a lot of people that wanted to make good in Australia, even though they probably wanted to be home amongst all their relations, but they came here not knowing what they're in for. And he decided through sheer determination to reinvent his craft and to produce a product that would be worthy of all Australians.
Our young queen has come to our young capital city of Canberra.
When I came to Australia, I was like a dumb cop. I couldn't speak a word of English.
Leaving behind her not only precious memories.
When I asked my father, you know, did you go to English school when you arrived here or something? He said, no, I listened to the radio. Because he said, who had time to go to school? He had to go to work and earn some money to pay the rent.
Here are the headlines.
I was listening. I didn't understand what they were saying, but I was listening. And I tried to pick up those words.
The Newcastle Waterfront strike has ended.
Slowly, slowly, in a few months' time, I started to speak English. I learned very quickly, but I'm still not 100% English.
My father keeps all his clients' details in these big old black books that he's had since he started working in Australia. When we were younger, we used to go and flick through them and look at all the names that were in there. And I always joke with him now because if you buy the BRW Top 200, we always count up out of the 200 how many of those names are in those black books. And it's quite a good percentage of them.
He had very nice customers. It was Sir Peter Abels, George Rocky, doctors, and surgeons, and the honorary Bob Hope, Ron Walker.
This is the original suit that he made for me when I went to the Commonwealth Games in Manchester. And would you believe I stood out in the rain during all the speeches, got sopping wet, and then had to sit there for 4 hours in my wetsuit. I went back to the hotel and hung it up, and we had a dry clean the next day, and I've been wearing it ever since. So it's a very resilient, well-made suit, you might say.
I never forget one day when I was at his business and Bob Hawke arrived, and he was the Prime Minister at that stage. And my father's business has a front window where he talks to the customers and things, and across the road there was a block of units. And Bob Hawke wasn't a shy man. He never went behind the curtain to get changed. He'd pull down his pants in front of my father and get changed. And somebody from across the road called out, Bob, we caught you with your pants down. And I'll never forget that day. It was a very funny day.
I guess it could have happened. Just shows what a relaxed country we are.
And I've got suits here. I can show you suits here which are 20 years old and 25 years old. And they're still good.
Unlike some of his customers, I usually only get one suit a year. A few years ago, I went in there and I asked for another suit. That's two suits in 1 year. He looked at me a little concerned and said, why did I want to have two suits? And I said to him, nobody lives forever. He seems to have taken offence about this, but he's forgiven me for it, I think.
We often talk about retirement, and he doesn't want to hear about it.
What would I do when I get up in the morning if I can't go to work? I would get crazy. I don't know. I wouldn't be able to live. I would die.
I think he can only make one suit of work these days, and he still worries that somebody else is going to steal his business, and so he has to go to work every day. My father used to relax by going out on the water in a boat fishing.
I used to love the sea, you know. I used to go outside the heads and go and catch fish. We always had in the freezer plenty of fish. I love fishing, and I love fish, but now I'm too old for it. It's finished. all gone.
Oh, there's a turtle sticking its head up there. See that?
I say I made the best choice in the world to come to Australia. I like it.
You know, it's nothing.
I liked it from the beginning, from the first time, because it was peaceful, it was quiet.
Well, I think he is a marvelous illustration of how fortunate this country has been. This man suffered the awful terror and privations of being a Jew in Europe under the Germans, escaped from that, came here, dedicated to making a new life, and in the process has also made a lot of bloody good suits for a lot of people.
He's more than a tailor to me. I wouldn't even suggest that I'm a personal friend of his. It's just that when we do meet, I'm always so pleased to see him, and I suspect that he's pleased to see me.
I don't think my personality is such that you could talk about it. I'm just a little tailor, nothing else.